We have seen now that we can actually generate these patches to fool one model for basically every possible input image. However, how transferable are they? So imagine, for example, you now try to fool one network, and now this network is updated, or we use a completely different architecture. Can we also fool that network with the same patches? So the fast gradient sign method usually is very specific to a model, but the patch idea you see already generalized over possible input images. So let's just try it. We take here a dense net, which is also trained on ImageNet, but has a different architecture as we have seen it. And we just try to fool it with our pineapple. So meaning that we take these pineapple patches of size 64 times 64 and place them randomly in an image and check how high actually the fooling accuracy is. This is of course more difficult because now we have trained this patch specifically for the ResNet 34, but we are now trying it here on a different model. So this is why we can actually check if these attacks are transferable or not. Finally, we can now see the accuracy, and we see that the full accuracy, although it's not as high as 99% in the case of our ResNet 34, we are still fooling the network quite good, with 65% of the images actually being predicted as a pineapple, and this shows us that yes, some attacks are actually transferable. So you can also try with different classes, different patch sizes. They will work differently, some better, some less. But in general, we can say these patch ideas, this transferability is there. So the original paper trained it, of course, these patches on multiple models, and these are then really transferable across models. And this shows you that actually there is some connection. This connection between these models is usually the data set they have been trained on. So if you have a multiple models that have been trained on ImageNet, then usually these patches can learn specific patterns in the data set. So they just try to find the bias that the model have picked up for specific classes in the data set and are able to represent that. And this then allows them to actually transfer across models and fool them quite a lot. This is quite dangerous also in the sense that you actually then don't really need to know the model. You don't need to have access to the weights. You just need to know what a data set has it been trained on, and then you can create your patch on different data, different set of models, and have actually a high chance to fool a model as a black box then here. That's why these patches are still can also be used as a black box attack. Now that we have discussed a couple of attacks, of course there is the question, can we actually protect ourselves against that? So when we performed the attacks above, we just took a pre-trained model on ImageNet and directly started fooling the network. However, what if we would actually be in the application and know that someone might try to attack this network? How could we actually protect ourselves against it? The easiest idea for white box attacks is, of course, to protect the model. So make sure if you're in an application, do not have the model anywhere public, any weights public, etc. However, this is, of course, not a full guarantee, as we have seen with transferability of patches or any black box attacks. There are different approaches that you can also take. For example, the intuitive one would be to set up adversarial training in the sense that we add actually these adversarial examples during the training to try to generalize the model over these attacks and be a good also defending mechanism. However, it has been shown that this rather results in a cat and mouse game, so that always the network just fixes the loopholes that the attacker finds and then opens up different ones. So it's very hard to actually train a model to be very good against any possible attack. Another idea that actually works sometimes better is that you use adversarial smoothing or distillation, sometimes called. This means that you train first one model on the labels and then you train a second model on the predictions of the first model. This allows you to have rather smooth label distribution, and therefore you don't overfit too much on specific labels, especially if, for example, an image doesn't have just one out of 1,000 classes, so even labeling will have some noise, and then your distillation actually helps you by detecting this. However, this still doesn't give you a guarantee to defend any possible attack here. Why are these networks, or especially also CNNs, so vulnerable against these attacks? So there are different explanations out there and intuitions. So it's hard to say now why exactly, but you can already imagine that if we have even given a large data set of images, like ImageNet, it still just represents a few points in a very high dimensional space. So still our data set is just very sparse in the high dimensional space. We trained the network on these points. However, what the network basically does is it learns this classification on a manifold, right? So basically on a lower dimensional surface inside this higher dimensional space. While if we would go away from the surface, then we actually don't know what the network will do. And this is exactly what these adversarial attacks try to do, to actually go outside the manifold that your network has learned. At the same time, you can actually also say that ReLU is one reason why these adversarial attacks work well. So as you know, ReLU sets all the negative values to zero and allows us with a very good gradient of the positive values to train very deep networks. However, the issue of ReLU is that it doesn't have any limitation to the top, right? So this noise actually, when if we do this fast gradient sign method, actually just tries to push some ReLU units to a very high value. These overpower than all other features in the region, and therefore the model predicts a different class than it actually should. Because we can just try to make these ReLU units actually to go to a very high value. Well, if you would take, for example, a ton H, you would saturate at some point. So you would really need to make sure that all of the units or many more units get a high value. This is why some people also say that ReLU-based activation functions give us already a disadvantage for defending. Finally, we come here to the conclusion of a notebook of this tutorial. So in this tutorial, we have seen how you can perform actually adversarial attacks and what adversarial attacks are there. We have specifically looked at white box attacks, which are based on calculating the gradient for the input, specifically either when adding some noise, which follows the gradient of fooling the network, while we can actually also calculate the gradients for patch, so that the network predicts a specific class. These adversarial attacks are very important if you would actually try to create a neural network for application. So in research, you usually don't have to worry about them. However, if you are deeply an engineer who really wants to put their model into application, you should be aware of these attacks and you should ask yourself if that can be an issue or not. If it is, then really try to defend your model, try to protect it by not sharing anywhere of the weights, and hopefully no one else will really start a big attack on your network for a black box attack. These ideas we have shown here are very transferable to the generative adversarial networks, which you have seen mostly in lecture 10. And hopefully this gives you also a better idea of how this GAN network actually works and why it works so well.